When we take a look at that second half of 2019, you've suggested that U.S. growth is a pillar to the TSX. You've also suggested that the U.S. economy right now is going through this Goldilocks phase, but other economists, if you will, indulge me, have said that we're looking through this through rose-colored glasses, that it's not as optimistic, you know, as it really is south of the border. Is what's going on in the U.S. economy enough to support us here?
From a perspective of clarity, I'm not an economist, nor do I play one on TV. I'm a strategist, so that means I'm an investor. I think the key thing that most investors are missing is that the U.S. is a home for stability. The growth in the U.S. in terms of GDP and earnings growth is the most stable in the world and has been for a long time. We saw a bump in GDP growth last year, basically more to do with the tax cuts and investors and companies buying back stock, and that really inflated the GDP number. It wasn't really about real growth. And now those growth numbers are coming back down to reality, what they were before the big tax cut. And we're not worried about that just because of the stability and diversification that U.S. growth in terms of earnings and GDP offers investors in the rest of the world. Now, the key theme with respect to Canada and how it relates to the United States is, as the U.S. goes, so goes Canada. You can explain about 90% of Canadian growth, both in terms of GDP and earnings growth, to the United States. Common sense, you already know this, right? Because Canada's number one trading partner is the United States. The United States' number one trading partner is Canada. It makes sense with respect to the proximity. It also makes sense given the lack of diversification with respect to the Canadian economy, and how there's several Canadian companies that are so connected with the U.S., the majority of their growth comes from the U.S. And so we believe that investors around the world will be coming back to North America, not just the United States, but Canada, with respect to stability, especially considering the fundamental volatility that we see increasing in areas like emerging markets in Europe.
You've also suggested that investors look outside of the big three, energy, materials, and financials, specifically.
We have some really great consumer companies in Canada. We have some really good rail companies in Canada. We have some really great telecom companies in Canada. And we think investors are massively underexposed these areas, principally because most investors that, let's say, benchmark themselves in buying ETFs in Canada automatically have a lot of bank stocks, a lot of energy stocks, and a lot of gold stocks. Now, we know from an individual basis, the stocks that everybody loves right now are gold, oil, and cannabis. And we think those areas are more cyclical and much more volatile with respect to other areas in the Canadian economy. Think about a company like Waste Connections. Waste Connections, 85 or 90% of their revenues come from the United States. What a great concept in terms of the waste business. Think about this theme. As the economy grows, we create more garbage. Waste Connections is the premier waste company in Canada. That's the type of company you want to own. Look at the rail companies. The rail companies, CP and CN, are so much better managed from our lens in terms of earnings and operating performance relative to their U.S. counterparts. Look at the telecom companies. It's a bit of a cartel, just like the banks are a bit of a cartel. The business is fixed. They all do very well and play nice in, quote unquote, the sandbox. They give off great dividends. Their cash flow is positive and growing, and they have good earnings. So we think those areas are areas where investors can, will, and should increase their positions longer term.
I want to get back to something that you just mentioned, oil, because we've seen it have some swings over the last decade. Is it a concern with respect to equities when you don't see these commodities rising?
No, because I think most investors want to replay the last cycle. The last cycle was this super cycle upward that we saw between 2002 and really 2012 to 2014, where oil was very, very strong, and commodities, for that matter, were really strong. Again, it goes back to the premise that Canada can work without commodities going up. We just got really excited because Canada did very well during the first decade of this new millennia. Now, you have to go back and do the research, and you'll see that that oil in particular runs in super cycles. We tend to think oil only goes up or down. Oil actually can have a super cycle trading range akin to what it had between 1982 and 2002. During that time frame, oil companies in Canada did very well. The province of Alberta and the city of Calgary really grew into the city that it was during a trading range environment. People forget that. So again, we said this about the rail companies. We think many oil companies in Canada are much better managed relative to their partners to the south, and that would include Companies like TransCanada, Enbridge, Suncor, we think those are exquisitely managed companies and, oh, by the way, have done very well in the past during oil trading range environments.
You still seem very big on financials, and even though the valuations in 2018 weren't so hot.
Valuations of it, if you look at valuations relative to other banks and the stability of other banks, do you have to ask yourself this question: do you want to own a European bank right now? And the answer is no. Do you want to buy a company in Canada, a bank in Canada, where the majority of its growth is coming from the United States, where the strongest growth is coming from, where cash flow remains exquisitely strong? We believe the Canadian banks in particular are great managers of capital, consistent dividend growth, consistent earnings, return on equity that has been very consistent. The U.S. banks are even better with respect to valuations right now and dividend growth, but the stability trade over the next decade, we believe, is going to continue to be the Canadian banks, especially those that are more centered on the United States, and that would include RBC, it would include TD, and it would include BMO.
Given that you've suggested that the U.S. economy is doing well, does the Federal Reserve need to cut rates?
You know, it's really interesting. We have now reared an entire generation of investors that only buy stocks because the Fed cuts interest rates. And for all intents and purposes, the momentum trade, those investors that are thinking kind of shorter term have bid up the stock market because they believe what the bond market was saying in terms of the Fed funds futures 3 rate cuts. Now, do we believe there's going to be 3 rate cuts? Our great economics department says there are going to be at least 2. The longer the stock market, though, goes up and continues to maintain near these levels, we think from a common sense perspective, the Fed most likely will cut once, which will undo the December cut, and then kind of see where the data lies in. Remember, global growth is still shaky. U.S. is the pillar with respect to stability. This is all about stability of growth. I think the Fed's message has to be that the economy is stable, and then we'll see after that whether or not they have to act further.
I think you've coined this phrase, as goes the U.S., so goes Canada. Will Canada follow suit?
Canada doesn't really need to, but they might, just in terms of what's happening with the currency. But Canadian GDP and Canadian job growth has been pretty steady, just like the U.S., so they probably would have to, just to keep pace.